In this video, I would like to show you how to use IO-Link function block libraries created with the function block factory. I am using a PLC from Beckhoff, TwinCat 3, with EtherCAT and Beckhoff IO-Link master. Once you have configured, created, and downloaded your function block library, you can include it into your project. To do so, you go at References, right mouse click, we open the library repository, and here we find the install button. Now we click on it. We will find under an already prepared folder, which I prepared, the library. We just select it and click it open. So now the library is installed. Now we can include the installed library into our project. To do so, we go back to References, right mouse click on it, and we say Add Libraries. And we know we find it under Miscellaneous, so we open it. And we find the WL9GC function block library we created. In here, we just click OK, and the function block library for the WL9 is installed. Now we are ready to use the included library. To do so, the first step is to declare the necessary variables. So the first one is an instance variable of the function block we are going to use, which I will call function block WL9CG. And it is, of course, of the type of the function block. So I find them here under this library. Here is my function block, and I'm just going to use it. So now the function block is the function block variable is declared. And now I also need a instance variable for the struct where all the data is in and when the selection is going to take place. I will just call it struct WL9CG. And this is of type of the struct. And I find it here in the data types, struct. I'm going to use this, and we are done with the declaration. We prepared everything to be able to start programming. So the first thing is we need to get rid of the older code. We don't need it anymore. So I'm just commenting it out. And first, we are going to call our function block using the instance variable, of course. This is our instance variable. I need the net ID, the address. We remember we get it from here. And I just write it in here. We don't need the master type and the slave address as we are using Beckhoff master, so those are default values. And then the port number, we remember that the device is connected to the port 3, so I just type in 3. And this is already differently to what we have done with the RDS read, because here we needed to know the syntax, how to address the port. So we encapsulate this as well. And the last thing I need to do is to tell which is the data variable, and this is of course our STWL9CC. So we are done with the programming. We can build to see whether everything's okay. And we see that we've got zero errors and zero warnings, so everything's okay. I can store it, and we are done. The next step is to check whether our program works. So I'm going to transmit the new code into the PLC. And I'm starting the PLC. Now we can see that we've got here the data with the selection section and the data section. And we just go to the selection section and select just all of the parameters we can read from this device. So I'm just playing the PLC, selecting all the parameters. I am also going to select the record. And you see you've got this all variables, or all the record elements are going to be reached. This makes it a little bit faster. And all. And here's our next variable. And I'm just continuing selecting it. Here we've got another record. And we are going to use the all variable here as well. And here come the next. And I'm still selecting it. I'm just going to try to read all of them so I know that everything works fine. So my selection is done. And of course, I need to trigger the start. So I'm going to the function block as well. And I see that there's a variable request. And I select it as well. So now everything is prepared to read it. Once I force those variables, the read request is going to be started. And just to see whether the reading works, we just open the data. And we see that most of the data is empty. Can go down with it, and now I transmit it, and we should observe that the data is going to be read in here. And what we see, okay, yeah, we are reading, and we are reading all this data, and we can also have a look into here, into the records, system state. Yeah, we remember we've been reading the system state. Now we know what the subindices mean. So it looks like everything worked fine. So we know what we have written works. And in the next step, we can do it a little bit more usable and writing a real PLC program. As the last act, we can finalize our program by selecting some variables, some parameters, or some diagnosis information, and to read them frequently. So I'm going to leave the online mode. I'm going to declare a bool variable, which I will call is selected. It's a bool. I'm just going to use it to check whether I already selected or not. And now we include an if here. And I'm just going to check for not is selected, then, and now we are going to do the selection. And we know that the variables, the selection is done in the stw, in the selection part, and now we can just select some variables. For instance, here the comparative value high. Selection is done with true, and I can copy this. This is going to be a little bit more efficient. I can also select the low. This is also true. And now we can select further, like debounce time. It might be an interesting diagnosis. Let us see what else we're going to find. Debounce time 1, debounce time 2. Probably it's interesting as well. But you see, I'm having all these parameters listed in here and all this information listed in here. I can just go through it. What else? What else do we have? Device status. This might be a very interesting information during runtime. Firmware version, probably not that much. Inverter, not really. endpoints, configuration, quality information is always interesting. Diagnosis. I'm going to take this one as well. So we can have some parameters being read. I saw that we've got this quality of run. This is very important. And you remember that we were also reading the system state. Let us see whether we are going to find it. This is our system state. Okay. So now we have done the selection, and once we have done the selection, we need to search is selected to true. So we do it just once. We don't need the PLC program just going through the code again and again and again. And what you see is we have done a selection of some variables, and we are going to read them automatically. So we need to trigger the read with the timer we have already prepared. Reading timer Q, and we are done. Let us build to see whether everything's okay. We have no errors. We can store it, and we are done. Now, finally, we can test our implementation. So I'm going to transmit the new program to the PLC. And start the PLC. And we already see that the selection works. And when we go to the data, we should observe that we have those parameters which we selected. So we see we are reading the device status, and you see that you get information device is okay. This is another advantage of using enumerators. If you do not use enumerators, you would just get a value of zero, which you see here. And this doesn't tell you that much. We've been also reading other parameters like quality of run, for instance. We see that we've got this value. And we've been reading the system state. And here we see which are the system state components and what they mean, which we did not do using the IDS reading program. So we see that our implementation is done, and everything works fine. I hope you got a good insight on how to use IODD function block libraries in the PLC environment. Thank you for watching.